اللهم إنا نستعينك ونستهدي.
Good morning. I will talk about the boundaries of the abdominal cavity. This is the abdominal cavity, which is continuous with the pelvic cavity. It has a roof formed of the abdominal diaphragm, which separates the abdominal cavity from the thoracic cavity. It has a floor formed of the pelvic diaphragm, which separates the abdominal or abdominopelvic cavity from the perineum. It has an anterior wall formed of the rectus abdominis muscle and the rectus sheath. It has posterior wall formed of the posterior abdominal wall, muscles and the fascia. And the lateral wall is formed of the oblique muscles, transversus abdominis and the transversalis fascia. The abdomen has six abdominal planes, four horizontal and two vertical planes. First one is the transpyloric plane. This transpyloric plane is at the level of the lower border of L1. Then the second one, subcostal plane, which is at the level of L3. Then we have another one at the upper border of the iliac crest, intercrestal or supracrestal plane, which is opposite L4. And intertubercular plane, which is opposite L5. The two lateral vertical planes are called the midclavicular planes or midclavicular lines, and each line crosses the tip of the ninth costal cartilage. The abdominal cavity or the abdomen can be divided into four compartments or nine compartments. It can be divided into four compartments by two planes. First, this is the umbilicus. Okay, umbilicus here. The first plane is the midline or median plane. The second one crosses the umbilicus. This one, transumbilical plane. They divide the abdomen into four compartments: left upper compartment, right upper compartment, left lower compartment, and right lower compartment. The left upper compartment contains the stomach and the spleen, left colic flexure. The right upper compartment contains the liver, right colic flexure. The right lower compartment contains the cecum, part of the ascending colon and the small intestine. The left lower compartment or quadrant contains sigmoid colon and part of small intestine. The abdomen is usually divided into nine compartments by the two lateral vertical planes, subcostal plane, and intertubercular plane. We have three compartments in the midline: epigastrium, umbilical, hypogastrium, and the three compartments on each side: right hypochondrium, left hypochondrium, right lumbar, left lumbar, right iliac fossa, and left iliac fossa. The right hypochondrium is occupied by the liver. The left hypochondrium contains the spleen. The right lumbar, ascending colon and right kidney. The left lumbar, descending colon and left kidney. The right iliac fossa, cecum, and the vermiform appendix. The left iliac fossa, sigmoid colon. The epigastrium, stomach and the liver, part of the liver. The umbilical and the hypogastrium contain small intestine. Then we discuss the important planes of the abdomen. The most important one is the transpyloric plane. You should know how to identify the transpyloric plane, and you should know the structures at the level of the transpyloric plane. Transpyloric plane is at the level of the lower border of L1. It crosses the tip of the 9th costal cartilage. It is usually 100 breaths below the xiphoid process. It is called the transpyloric plane because it crosses the pylorus of the stomach and the first part of the duodenum. Here at the tip of the 9th costal cartilage, the fundus of the gallbladder. Here the neck of the pancreas. And the neck of the pancreas is the landmark for the origin of two structures. Origin of the portal vein and the origin of superior mesenteric artery. Hilum of the right kidney, or hilum of each kidney, right and left. And the end of the spinal cord, conus medullaris, in the adult. These are the structures at the level of the transpyloric plane. Number one, pylorus and the first part of the duodenum. Number two, fundus of the gallbladder. Number three, neck of the pancreas, which marks two important structures. Origin of the portal vein, origin of the superior mesenteric artery, hilum of each kidney, and end of the spinal cord. Then the subcostal plane, again, you should know how to identify it and the structures at the level of the subcostal plane. It is at the level of L3, third lumbar vertebra. This is the costal margin. The lowest point of the costal margin is rib number 10. So actually it lies between the lower points of the costal margin, below the 10th costal cartilage. Structures at this level, okay. Third part of the duodenum. Remember that the first part is at the level of the transpyloric plane. Second structure, origin of the inferior mesenteric artery. And remember that the origin of the superior mesenteric artery is at the level of the transpyloric plane. Then intercrystal plane and intertubercular plane. Again, how do I to identify each one? And the structures at the level of each one. Intercrystal plane, this one, is at the level of L4, between the highest points of the iliac crest. It marks the bifurcation of the abdominal aorta. Intertubercular plane is at the level of L5. It is the line between the tubercles of the iliac crest, and it marks the beginning of the inferior vena cava. The peritoneum, this one, the serous membrane. What should you know about the peritoneum? Okay, definition, organization. Peritoneal cavity, peritoneal folds, blood supply, nerve supply, and the function. According to the definition, it is a serous membrane which lines the wall of the abdomen and surrounds the viscera. Therefore, it is organized into two layers, parietal layer and the visceral layer. And the peritoneal cavity is the cavity between the parietal layer and the visceral layer. This is the organization of the peritoneum, organized into two layers. Parietal layer, which lines the wall of the abdomen, okay. Visceral layer, which surrounds the viscera and form folds, which connect this viscera with the posterior abdominal wall. The peritoneal cavity is the cavity between the parietal layer and the visceral layer. Then the peritoneal folds. You should know the formation, the names, and the function. Formation. Some organs are covered anteriorly with peritoneum, only anteriorly with peritoneum, like the kidney. So the kidney doesn't have fold of peritoneum. Other organs, like the ascending colon and the descending colon, are covered anteriorly and on the sides. Again, they don't have any fold. Other organs, like the small intestine, this one, okay, small intestine, are completely covered with peritoneum and suspended from the posterior abdominal wall by a fold of peritoneum. We name the peritoneal folds according to the organs attached to it. If they are attached to the stomach, they are called omentum. We have greater omentum and lesser omentum. If it is attached to the colon, if it is attached to the small intestine, it is called the mesentery. If it is attached to the large intestine, it is called the mesocolon. If it is attached to the spleen and the liver, it's called the ligaments, like falciform ligament, coronary and the triangular ligaments, gastrosplenic ligament, lienorenal ligament. Actually, the gastrosplenic ligament between the spleen and the stomach is also called gastrosplenic omentum. The lesser omentum, which connects the stomach with the liver, is also called gastrohepatic ligament. These folds transmit blood vessels and the nerves from the posterior abdominal wall to the viscera. Again, in case of the stomach, this is the stomach. Lesser curvature and the greater curvature. It has lesser omentum attached to the lesser curvature, greater omentum attached to the greater curvature. In case of large intestine, like this one, transverse colon, it has transverse mesocolon. Actually, only two parts of the large intestine have mesocolon. The transverse colon has transverse mesocolon, and the sigmoid colon has sigmoid mesocolon. Then regarding the ligaments, this is the stomach, this is the liver, this is the spleen, this is the kidney. Okay, the spleen has two ligaments, one connecting it with the stomach, this one, which is called the gastrosplenic ligament. The other one connecting the spleen with the kidney, with the left kidney, is called lienorenal ligament. This is the liver. It has a ligament connecting it with the anterior abdominal wall. It's called the falciform ligament. Okay, this is the lesser omentum attached to the lesser curvature of the stomach. Regarding the blood supply and the nerve supply of the peritoneum. The peritoneum has parietal layer and the visceral layer. Actually, the parietal layer belongs to the body wall. The visceral layer belongs to the viscera. That's why the parietal layer is supplied by the same arteries, same nerves, which supply the body wall. The visceral layer is supplied by the same arteries and the nerves, which supply the viscera. So regarding the nerve supply, The parietal layer supplied by lower six thoracic nerves, T7 to T12, supplied by L1, which form iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal nerves, also supplied by the phrenic nerve, which supplies the roof of the abdominal cavity. The visceral layer is supplied by the autonomic nerves of the related viscera. That's why the parietal layer is sensitive to pain, because it is supplied by somatic nerves. The visceral layer is not sensitive to pain because it is supplied by autonomic nerves, but it is sensitive to stretch. The blood supply, parietal layer by the arteries of the body wall, visceral layer by the arteries of the related viscera, same apply for the lymph drainage. About the peritoneal cavity. What should you know about the peritoneal cavity? Okay. Definition, contents, and the divisions. Peritoneal cavity is the cavity between the parietal layer and the visceral layer of the peritoneum. Contents. Normally, it contains a small amount of serous fluid for lubrication of the viscera, but it may contain abnormal collection of fluids. Like what? Like pus in case of peritonitis, inflammation of the peritoneum, like blood in case of internal hemorrhage, like excessive serous fluid as in ascites. The peritoneal cavity is divided into two sacs, lesser sac behind the stomach and the greater sac anterior to the stomach. So remember, the stomach separates the greater sac anteriorly from the lesser sac posteriorly. What about the lesser sac? This one. This is the lesser sac. At the tip of the arrow, this one. This is the liver. This is the spleen. Stomach. This is the transverse colon. And this is the pancreas. And these are the structures behind the stomach, or we can call it the structures forming the stomach bed. The anterior wall of the lesser sac, this is the anterior wall of the lesser sac, formed by four structures. This is number one, caudate lobe of the liver. This is number two, lesser omentum. This is number three, stomach or posterior surface of the stomach. This is number four, the anterior two layers of the greater omentum. This is the posterior wall. Okay. From blue upward, this is the posterior two layers of the greater omentum. And this one, the transverse colon. This one, the transverse mesocolon. And then the structures forming the stomach bed. The roof, this one, is the peritoneum lining the diaphragm. And the floor here is the fusion of the anterior two layers and the posterior two layers of the greater omentum. Actually, you call this inferior recess of the lesser sac, and we call this superior recess of the lesser sac. Again, boundaries of the lesser sac. This is the liver, stomach, transverse colon, pancreas, and this is the lesser sac. So we'll talk about the anterior wall, this one, anterior wall. Remember, four structures. This is number one, caudate lobe of the liver. This is number two, lesser omentum. This is number three, posterior surface of the stomach. This is number four, anterior two layers of the greater omentum. Then the posterior rule, this one. From here, posterior two layers of the greater omentum, transverse colon, transverse mesocolon, and the peritoneum covering the stomach bed. Then here, the roof is the peritoneum lining the diaphragm, superior recess, and the floor is the fusion of the anterior and the posterior two layers of the greater omentum, forming the inferior recess of the lesser sac. Again, this is the stomach. Okay, this is the stomach. This is the lesser omentum. This is the greater omentum. Okay, lesser omentum, greater omentum. This is the right border. This is the left border. So the right border here, right border of the greater omentum, right border of the greater omentum, and in the upper part, it is the opening to the lesser sac, epiploic foramen. Actually, the lesser sac and the greater sac are completely separated from each other, except at the opening to the lesser sac. The left border, this is the left border. Okay? This is the left border of the greater omentum. This is the spleen. Okay? And here, the hilum of the spleen, gastrosplenic ligament, and the gastro and the lienorenal ligament, and this angle is called splenic recess of the lesser sac. Okay, the greater sac is completely separated from the lesser sac except at the opening to the epiploic foramen. This is the opening to the epiploic foramen. You should know the boundaries. This is the anterior boundary or anterior wall. This is the posterior wall. This is superior and this is inferior. Anteriorly, it is the free margin of the lesser omentum containing three structures. Anterior and to the right, this is the bile duct. Anterior and to the left, this is the hepatic artery. And behind the two is the portal vein. I call it prince and the princess and the bodyguard. Bile duct anterior and to the right, hepatic artery anterior and to the left, portal vein behind the two. Behind the epiploic foramen is this large vein, inferior vena cava, this one. Therefore, the epiploic foramen separates two veins, separates the portal vein from the inferior vena cava. Superiorly, it is the caudate process of the caudate loop. Inferiorly, here, it is the first part of the duodenum. This is the lesser sac behind the stomach. This is the epiploic foramen, stomach, liver, spleen, kidney. So, this is the gastrosplenic ligament. This is the lienorenal ligament. Again, this is the epiploic foramen. This is the inferior vena cava. Okay, again, this is the stomach. The sac outside the stomach, this one, anterior to the stomach, is the greater sac. The sac behind the stomach is the lesser sac. It has an opening. This opening communicates the lesser sac with the greater sac. This one. This is the lesser omentum. This is the free margin of the lesser omentum. So anterior to the epiploic foramen is the free margin of the lesser omentum, containing the bile duct anterior and to the right, hepatic artery anterior and to the left, portal vein behind the two. Behind the epiploic foramen is the portal vein. Again, the epiploic foramen separates the portal vein anteriorly from the inferior vena cava posteriorly. This is the stomach. Okay, this is the stomach. This is the liver. Caudate lobe of the liver. This is the lesser sac. This one. Behind the stomach. This is the lesser sac. In front of the stomach. This is the greater omentum. Okay. This is the transverse colon. Small intestine. And this is the mesentery of the small intestine. The greater sac is divided into anterior compartment and posterior compartment. Anterior compartment, this one, is anterior to the lesser omentum, anterior to the stomach, anterior to the greater omentum. Posterior compartment is posterior to the greater omentum, posterior to the transverse colon, anterior to the posterior abdominal wall. And the best wishes.